Once again, this is the place for intellectual honesty, spiritual honesty, and even biblical honesty, if you can believe that. Tonight, we're going to have a great show, and with that said, I would like to bring in my co-host, Robert Graves.
Hey, how are you doing?
I'm doing marvelous, wonderful. I certainly have been enjoying actually, the conversation between you and Ozzy, it's been awesome.
You know, it has been awesome. And, I hope that other people are finding it meaningful and very useful, really, because I think there's a lot to be offered in the entire conversation, really.
Before I bring in Ozzy tonight, I would like to say hello to Daryl. Daryl, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Here, looking forward to it as always.
I've got a feeling that things are going to get tense tonight, which is nice. And so, Daryl, please look at all of the comments that will come in, and let's work from there, because I think that we can have this kind of show that's full of substance and passion. And so if you would be so kind as to do that and bring out the best in comments, because we certainly want to recognize all of our viewers because they mean so much to us. It's the way the NCG works.
Absolutely.
There you go. With that said, Ozzy, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's always a pleasure. And the subject of the great debate, well, I mean, that's really part of why I'm on YouTube. I mean, I have other interests on YouTube, but my participation in the Great Debate is obviously because I think it's an important question and an interesting question. The fact that there's actually an NCG hangout, the place, a show about the Great Debate itself, as soon as I saw the title, I thought, okay, I got to get in on this.
You're smiling a bit much here. I mean... Do you have some things in mind already to go for?
No, actually, I don't have an agenda. I have thoughts on the Great Debate. I'm not bringing an agenda or anything like that. Maybe the first thing I would say, is that, there's a lot of eye rolling. There's a lot of people who are embarrassed by the expression, the Great Debate, right? People will often say it in a funny way, the Great Debate or something like that, right? They'll put scare quotes around it. They'll do some kind of gesture to indicate that they don't really mean that it's a great debate. And I find it interesting that people are embarrassed by the expression itself, because I'm not embarrassed by it. I think it helps to understand why it's called the Great Debate. It's because the question of God's existence is debatable. And it's consequential to people all over the world, and it has been for millennia. So this debate is great in the sense of scale and scope and longevity. it's not a question of the quality of the debate or the caliber of the people involved in the discourse. It's just a question of how consequential the subject is to people, and how enduring and how widespread this argument is. That's what makes it great. It's great in the sense of magnitude and significance to people, not in terms of the quality of the arguments put back and forth. There are, of course, people who I think argue at very high levels about these things, but most people are just sort of out there opining with no particular training or information or background reading or anything like that on the subject. But the great debate is not an assessment of the quality. It's about the scale and how consequential the discussion and the argument is. And if you keep that in mind, it doesn't seem so ridiculous. You're not going to be embarrassed by using the expression the great debate. That's why I'm not embarrassed. That's why I use the expression freely and without embarrassment. It's also part of what's called the great conversation. That's another expression that's sometimes used, the great conversation, which refers to not just the great debate, but the entire discourse within the Western tradition of philosophy. You know, the idea that of looking at the best that has been thought and said throughout Western history, you know, starting with, you know, the pre-Socratics and moving all the way up through the history of ideas, right? All these great conversations about politics, about morality, about God's existence, about science, about the meaning of life, and what is art, and you know, all of these big questions, right? That where people talk to previous generations, they read what was written before and has been said before, and they answer it, right? It's sometimes been said that everything in the history of philosophy is just a footnote to Plato, right? I mean, that's the sense in which there's this great conversation. There's a conversation that transcends human lifetimes. And the great debate is just one debate within the great conversation.
Before we get started in talking about the great debate, last week you did something that I think that really helps the conversation. You were able to take and really unpack concerning justified true belief, that is in the context of knowledge and how Gautier and others treated that. Tonight, I would like to ask you another question. I think that you're familiar with Mr. Truetemp.
Truetemp? No, I don't know that name.
Okay. Let me read this. It's rather simple. I think it's going to be an easy for you. And so I'm going to read this rather slowly, so everyone in our audience, along with people here in the studio, will get it. It says, one day Charles is suddenly knocked out by a falling rock, and his brain becomes rewired so that he is always absolutely right whenever he estimates the temperature where he is. Charles is completely unaware that his brain has been altered in this way. A few weeks later, this brain rewiring leads him to believe that it is 71 degrees in his room. Apart from his estimation, he has no other reasons to think that it is 71 degrees. In fact, it is at that time 71 degrees in his room. Does Charles really know that it is 71 degrees in the room, or does he only believe it?
Oh, I love that. That's a great thought experiment. You know, what's funny is I wrote my master's thesis was on something called the enabling assumptions that inform naturalized epistemology. And I used a thought experiment in there in which I came up with something kind of like that. I came up with this concept called epistemic angels. Imagine a race of people who, by virtue of the kinds of critters that they are, where they evolved, and, you know, their beliefs are invariably correct. It just so happens they're whatever they believe, it's correct. Right. If a belief bubbles up in them, it's because it's caused by the actual state of affairs, and so it's always correct. They don't know the reasons. They have no current thoughts that would justify it in their own minds. They just happen to always be right, but not coincidentally always be right. They are causally connected to the facts, so that their beliefs are actually causally resulting from the state of affairs that are the object of their beliefs. So their beliefs are always true, and as a result of the facts in question. And so these are epistemic angels. These are beings that are fortunately always in a position to know things, but they don't know that they know. They have no reasons. If you ask them why they believe that, they say, I don't know. It's just that this idea bubbled up in my head. And of course, they never find out that they're wrong, because of course they're never wrong. And so they invariably trust every belief that they have. with complete assurance. So it's just sort of a limiting case, an idealization, a limiting case of what it would be like to always be in possession of the facts. And Mr. True Temp here, who always knows the true temperature, I've never heard that particular thought experiment. I wonder if, could you tell me how old that is, like where that came from? I'm wondering if I plagiarized it by mistake and didn't realize.
Let's see. I have it written down. That is, it goes back to 1990. And this is actually, it's been remodeled since then by Nichols and Stitch.
Stephen Stitch, yeah.
You're right, in 2001. It was employed in this kind of context. And let me state this. The results were amazing. In fact, they were doing this both with Westerners and actually East Asians. And, you know, when it comes to Westerners, the ones that thought that it meant, you know, this gentleman really knew, 32% of the Westerners thought that he really knew something. 68%, therefore, thought that he only believed. When it comes to the East Asians, only 12% of the East Asians thought that he really knew. And 88% of them thought that it was only a belief set. What are your thoughts on this? Because it's almost like, you know, when we're dealing with these particular models, trying to figure out knowledge, this cognitive process, we are looking at it from various angles. Could you elaborate on that a bit?
Yeah, sure. Okay, well, first of all, I actually have met Stephen Stitch. When I was a graduate student, when I was doing my master's degree in Montreal, he was an external auditor. He was invited by our university, by the philosophy department that I belong to. Was he at Rutgers at the time? I think. Anyway, he was invited to come and be an external auditor to assess our philosophy department. That's what philosophy department. Well, all departments do this. They get people from other departments in other universities to come, and look at their curriculum, look to their faculty, talk to their students, and do this. And so I had a lot of conversations with Stephen Stitch because he was in town for about a week, doing this, and we talked about a few things about epistemology. He has some very unusual ideas, but he's very empirically minded, and so he engages in what you might call, I don't know that he'd call it this, but this has been sometimes called experimental epistemology, and that's what this is. Let's go out and actually hit people with some thought experiments and in large numbers and poll them and find out what would they say. And of course, there are differences. People in different age groups, people of different genders, people from different cultures will respond to these questions differently, especially for something like knowledge, because of course, knowledge is a culturally laden term. It's a value laden term. And in some contexts, the word knowledge is just, it's a big thing. It's knowledge. It's important. And in other cultures, the word knowledge means a little more than awareness. And so where you set the bar on knowledge might differ from place to place. In one place, knowledge might be something that's very hard to obtain. And another culture, the concept of knowledge as they use it might be a different concept. The bar might be lower. It might be something that, it's easy. You can know all kinds of things all the time that other people would not countenance as knowledge. So in a case like Mr. True Temp, my own feeling would be this. If Mr. True Temp has a feeling, a hunch or whatever, that leads him to estimate the temperature of the room or wherever he is, and it's invariably correct, this is either just a weird metaphysical coincidence, in which case, his brain is wired a certain way, and it just so happens that, irrespective of the facts, that he happens to have true estimations of the temperature, in which case he doesn't know. But I would say that if, however, his brain was wired in such a way such that he was experiencing the mean kinetic energy of the air molecules around him, and his brain was able to turn that into a feeling, a hunch about the temperature, and to issue an estimate, and that belief was causally connected, through this rewiring and through what's going on in his sensory surfaces, and related to the mean kinetic energy in the air around him. If, in other words, his mental states, his estimates, systematically co-varied with the actual temperature around him, in a causal way, then I'd say he knows what he thinks he knows, even if he hasn't a clue how he knows, right? I mean, ask yourself, how do you know if it's hot or cold? You know, well, it just feels hot or cold. Yeah, but, you know, how do you know that it feels hot? How do you know that it feels cold? What, you know, I can't analyze it more than that. It just feels hot or cold. Well, Mr. True Temp just has a way of doing what you and I already do, but it's a much more finely grained, highly calibrated ability to do what we already do. And so I know if it's hot or cold in the room because I am, in fact, causally connected to the temperature of the room. I have a brain and a body that allows me to experience feelings of a bodily heat and cold in ways that systematically co-vary with the temperature of the room. And if Mr. True Temp just happens to be able to do that in a more quantitatively reliable way, then of course he knows what he thinks he knows, just as we know the temperature in the room, because it's not a coincidence. But if it was just, if his brain were just scrambled or rewired, and it just so happened that he always knew what the temperature or always estimated correctly, but there was no causal connection, then I would say, no, he doesn't actually know. It's just a fluke. Nobody should trust what's going on there. It's just like he was rolling dice and making a prediction on the basis of rolling dice or flipping a coin, and he happened to get a run of luck. That wouldn't be knowledge. Now, people in different cultures are going to have different ideas about what constitutes knowledge. And for some people, it's just going to be awareness. For some people, it's just going to be having a belief that turns out to be right. For some people, it's going to be what I described. You have to be connected to the facts in some way, causally. And that, I think, is going to account more than anything else for these discrepancies that we would find across cultures.
That was excellent, by the way. I just need to say that. That was excellent.
Yeah.
Loved it.
Ozzy keeps, you know, not just hitting home runs. He knocks grand slams, and that's why he's at the place. Come on, Bob.
Yeah. No, I thought the question is not really one that can be answered yes or no. The question has to then come back at the question and say, well, you know, how are we defining, you know, knowledge? If we're going to define knowledge that one has to be also aware of the process by which they come to this information, that's a little bit tougher standard. But as Ozzy points out, if there is some sort of a connection between what the temperature actually is and the way that the estimation comes about, even though the person isn't aware of it, then he's basically a walking thermometer. By the way, we have a Mr. True Temp in this area. There's actually a company here called True Temp.
That's cool.
That's awesome. One more question before we get into the great debate, unless you want to say a little bit more concerning Mr. True Temp.
Well, not Mr. True Temp specifically, but you mentioned Stephen Stitch, who has done some work on this. Stephen Stitch is kind of an interesting fellow. He's a philosophical pragmatist. He and I had a lot of conversations about epistemology and philosophy of science. He works in the philosophy of science. He works in the cognitive sciences. And, you know, I told him I was working epistemology and all that. And we had some interesting discussions. And in the course of the discussion, he mentioned that he doesn't believe in epistemology. He doesn't think that epistemology should be a branch of philosophy. He doesn't think that there's such a thing as knowledge. He doesn't think that it's a category that's meaningful. He doesn't think that the concept knowledge that you're not carving nature at its joints when you're dividing the sort of the philosophical pie into sort of ethics and aesthetics and metaphysics and you know, there's just philosophy of science. There's just science there, but there isn't epistemology. Epistemology is just sort of a confused conceptual category. And so he doesn't actually really believe in knowledge in a traditional philosophical sense. And he doesn't think that there's a branch of philosophy, properly speaking, that
is
epistemology.
I'm curious, is it because he doesn't think that it really handles the question well? I mean, obviously people talk about it, you know.
Well, it's a little hard to say because we didn't have enough discussions about it. So I'm a little leery of overstating what his reasons are. Also, this is a conversation that we had like 20 years ago. So I don't know. He might have changed his mind completely. I mean, I was a new graduate student at the time. So this is like a 20-year-old conversation. He could be anywhere now. I haven't spoken to him since. So I don't know what his position would be now.
And he might be thanking you to this very day for having changed his mind.
No, I doubt that. I was very, very much awed by him. In fact, I had his work figured very prominently in my own master's thesis. So when I found out that Stephen Stitch was coming to our department to do an audit, I was like, oh, great, I'm going to get to talk to this guy whose books I've been reading and whose ideas I have been, cobbling into my own ideas for my own thesis work. So I was just ecstatic. I would be very much astonished if anything I said influenced him.
Before we stumble into the great debate chatter tonight, just a couple of more questions. Because, you know, when I look at epistemic cognition, that is the study of it, it seems like it's broken into different domains in that. Let me see if I can put it in this context. You have well-definedness, and then you have ill-definedness. Now, could you speak to that for a few minutes?
I'm sorry, I didn't get an audio there. There was something, okay. Dr. Jones, I could see you talking about.
Okay.
Could you repeat the question?
Yes. Let me start from the very beginning, because can you hear me?
Yeah, you're a little faint, but go ahead.
I can hear you fine, but so I'm not sure what's going on.
Yeah. Okay, when it comes to the study, namely of epistemic cognition, it seems like these individuals who are, you know, studying the cognitive sciences and trying to figure all this stuff out, they are actually putting these things in, let's say, domain fields. And you have two categories that I would like for you to just fill us in about, and that would be well-definedness and ill-definedness. Could you speak to that?
I'm not sure I understand the question. Like, I mean, I understand the concept of what it means for something to be well-defined or ill-defined, but I don't understand how it applies particularly to epistemology.
Well, I have a quote here, and I might be able to find it real quick, but some state that when it comes to the ill-definedness, those domains that are in that category, that, you know, epistemic cognition, namely the study of it, is quite slippery. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, well, I mean, all of epistemology is kind of slippery. I mean, there are some domains that are well defined, that are narrowly circumscribed, and you know, they're clear and distinct. That is, they're sort of nice, clear conceptual boundaries in certain domains, right? In certain domains of inquiry, we know what we're talking about. We know where we know what is a legitimate question that belongs in this domain, and what is not a question that belongs in this domain, right? Epistemology is a weird one. Epistemology seems to have to do with knowledge, but if it has to do with knowledge, well, then it must be somehow tied to truth. Well, what is truth? Well, truth has to do with the world. It has to do with the world independently of our minds, right? But it also has to do with belief. Well, what's a belief? Well, belief is a psychological state. It's a subjective state, right? As opposed to an objective state of affairs, like a fact. A fact is something that's going on out there in the world. A state of affairs is, you know, not necessarily something going on in your head, but you know, going out there in the world. But a belief is a subjective experience, right? So there are certain subjects, like epistemology, where to study epistemology, you have to have an understanding of the theory of truth. You have to have an understanding of logic. Well, what is logic? Well, logic is a really queer thing. Logic is kind of like math. It somehow seems somewhat mind independent, but at the same time, it's only accessible to the mind. But the verities seem to transcend any particular mind. It's not like you're having an experience when you're doing logic, right? That is, logic doesn't consist merely of having a mental experience in the way that you know, hearing a piece of music is an auditory experience, right? So you have to study some logic. You have to study some science, some philosophy of science. You have to study brains to understand how brains and perceptual systems and memory work, and pick up information about what's going on in the world. But you have to have an understanding of what a mind is, and what a belief is, and what a mental state is, and you know, talk of intentionality, and then they're all. When you get into the mental, there are all kinds of queer phenomena like consciousness and first-person subjective perspective. I mean, the boundaries of epistemology are like you know, they're very elastic. They're very, very fluid. And to study epistemology is to have your fingers in a lot of people's pies. You have to be all over the cognitive sciences. You have to know some logic. Maybe that's what you're getting at. I'm not sure. I fear I might not be answering the question, but I hope I am.
I think that you've done well here tonight. The topic tonight is about the great debate. Some people feel like the great debate is not so great. Other people are enjoying the great debate to the extent that it just is on their mind all the time. And so I would like to hear your thoughts tonight. Bob, why don't you start it out?
Okay, well, I would certainly be one of those people who's not impressed with the so-called great debate. I don't find it great at all. I find it distracting, and I find debate to be a format ill-suited to the question. And although I think that there are a lot of people who've done a great deal of very useful thinking in terms of preparing for these debates and responding to them, I think that this debate, because of the nature of the question, ends up being only far more polarizing and creating far more disrespect between people of differences than it needs to. It doesn't always do that, but I don't find the debate to be great. And to be honest with you, I have not watched or participated in very many of those debates, but the ones that I have watched, I feel like I'm wasting my time. I would much rather sit down and talk to these people, chit-chat with them about, okay, where are you coming from? And I would much rather seek to understand what it is they have to say, where they're coming from, and why this makes sense, without necessarily trying to oppose them or find fault or win or lose or score points or, you know, put them in a position where they hem and haw. So I find it a bit too pretentious, so I'm not really all that impressed with it. Although I do agree, you know, in terms of what Ozzie said, that it's the question is certainly highly consequential to many people, and it is the scale of the question is certainly huge. I mean, we're talking about something that may hinge on why reality is reality at all, you know, which is which of course means everything, you know. And I would consider, however, the discussion that can happen between people who believe and people who don't believe as being part of a great discussion. But in terms of debate, I'm not so impressed.
Ozzie, what are your thoughts on what Bob said?
Bob is evaluating or understanding, interpreting the expression great debate in terms of quality of the discourse. And so I would agree with him there. The quality of the discourse is not great. So as I said, I use the expression great debate unabashedly because I think I understand the sense in which that expression arose and how it was intended to be understood. But I certainly am not impressed with debates that I see and hear about whether or not God exists. I mean, if I watch a debate between a prominent apologist and some prominent atheist, and I am not usually very impressed. Most people don't come by their theism, their atheism, their agnosticism, their apatheism, their igtheism, whatever. They don't usually come to it on the basis of a dispassionate consideration of the reasons for and against. Right. They usually come to these things for quite different reasons. You know, you just inherited these ideas, you sort of drunk them in, or else perhaps you've adopted a certain posture in reaction to what you used to believe that you're no longer satisfied with. And then, you know, people watch a debate or they hear people arguing, and then they have a tendency to just line up. You know, they just, you know, side with their team, and they have a tendency to think that the person that is arguing for their side, their position, is just scoring points left and right, and the other person is just, you know, sounding like an idiot. I mean, one of the most predictable and tiresome facts about a debate between any theist and atheist online, in a public lecture, on a forum, wherever, one of the most predictable, sadly predictable things is that people on both sides will think that their guy won, you know, and I just roll my eyes. It's one of the reasons why I don't do debates. I think that they're pointless. They're pointless. People, it's like, it would be like watching WWF wrestling or whatever, WWE wrestling, or whatever it's called these days. And watching a wrestling match between a white man and a black man, and then saying, whoever wins, that settles it. You know, which race is superior, you know, like, well, that's stupid. You know, you're going to see is, you know, I mean, assuming it's not a stage fight, but a real fair fight, all you're going to see is who's better at debating on that day.
Yeah.
Right. Which of these two people is better at debating? I mean, I can go into a debate and I know that if I wanted to, there are some people that I could positively own. And there are some people who could positively own me and make me and humiliate me. Right. But that wouldn't establish which of our positions is correct. Right. Now, this doesn't mean that reasons don't matter. I think reasons do matter. But I think debates don't matter. Right.
Yeah.
So the great debate sort of construed, you know, across individuals and across time, I think is useful and interesting, and I think it's rewarding for people to invest themselves in it and learn about it. I think if people try to be dispassionate about it, they can learn from it and revise their opinions, not just accumulate arguments in support of their position. They can actually think, hey, wait, there are liabilities with my position. This was a good counter to my position, and reevaluate and both either strengthen their position or weaken their position, have their confidence in their position scale up or scale down. I think that's all good. But unfortunately, most people will not do that. Most people are just going in with a bias. They're just looking for confirmation, of their existing position. And,
It sounds to me like we're probably very much in agreement as to how we assess it all. I do think the question is great. I do think that the discussion is extremely useful. And I find that and I'll be honest with you, my theism changed radically when I began to talk to people who don't agree with me, and I sought to understand them. And when I could see how much sense they were able to make and how they had such excellent questions and real problems with certain ideas, it really forced me to say, well, I got a little more homework to do here. I really need to begin letting go of some things as well. And so I found that conversation, I would say, extremely useful. I wouldn't be the so-called unconventional pastor today if I hadn't been open to that. But to me, I guess it's that maybe not the way that it has been traditionally used, but the way that it's being used today and the kind of people who are being attracted to it, I feel like it's become a distraction, and maybe we need to find a better term to market this conversation, but still have this conversation.
Hey, guys, before it becomes too boring, can you guys hear me?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear now.
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to give you an example of what typically goes on Facebook. I was sent this particular, this is not something that I authored, but it's something that was given to me, namely for this show. Let me read just a bit of it. I think you will get the gist of it before I go too far. And please jump in if you would like to stop me and say enough nonsense or whatever. The Christian starts out. Here's the Christian. Are you ready for the second coming of the invisible dragon? The atheist replies, what? That's ridiculous. There's no such thing as an invisible dragon. The Christian comes back and says, you need to be careful. If you don't believe in the invisible dragon, you, my unbelieving friend, will be left behind. The atheist replies, are you crazy or what? The Christian says, it sounds like you've never heard the truth or ever read the Invisible Dragon Bible. The atheist replies, the Invisible Dragon Bible? Can you see this Invisible Dragon Bible? Or is it a work of fiction? The Christian replies, it's not fiction, it's fact. The word of the invisible dragon is the invincible dragon, and there isn't one word in the invincible dragon Bible that isn't true. The invincible dragon makes that quite clear in the invisible dragon Bible. The atheist replies, do what? You're serious, aren't you? Christian, yes, it's a matter of life and death. Atheist, you've got to be joking. Christian, you need to repent before it's too late. Atheist, too late for what? Christian, the soon and coming wrath of the invisible dragon. Atheist, why would you think of something so stupid? Christian, have you ever seen one? Atheist, what? And so on and so on. My question tonight is, what do you think about these kinds of conversations that continue to happen on Facebook and on other platforms?
Well, my feeling is that a lot of these arguments are rehearsed moves, right? People have heard an argument and they know it's like judo. Like in judo, there, you know, for every move, you know, every hold, there's some other move that if you know enough judo, you can break that hold. And, you know, and the great debate is a lot like that. You know, people say, oh, you know, you're going to use this argument. Oh, well, then I'm going to use the flying spaghetti monster. Oh, you're going to use the flying spaghetti monster. Well, then I'm going to use this counter argument. Right. And I mean, if you're new to the great debate and you're learning these moves, it's very exciting. It's very thrilling, you know, but if you've been in it for a while, you roll your eyes, which is why there are so many people in the great debate who watch the great debate, who participate in comments and but not necessarily get into debates themselves, but who roll their eyes and, oh no, here we go again. We've heard it all before. Right. And the reason we've heard it all before is because so much of this is stereotypical. There are dance steps here. Right.
Yes.
And what you described there, what you read there is like, yeah, okay. I've heard that very argument, that set of moves, those steps, right. That little tango, you know, the atheist theist tango, right? that goes on. And I don't know. I did it too. And I found it interesting at the time when I was doing it. But once you've done it long enough and you've seen other people doing it, it's predictable. And you know where it goes, and you know that one person isn't going to get changed by this. These are highly ineffective arguments, usually.
Yeah. Do you think it's similar with chess, where, I mean, usually your beginner chess player is just trying to find a way to control the board, but your advanced chess player is many times following a kind of a pre-programmed script of this is what you do in these kinds of situations. And your masters, they know so many of these configured plays, and they're trying to find a way of varying them in a way that's not anticipated, expected, and catching their opponent off guard, which is so hard to do, I tell you. But there is a sense in which at a certain level, the game becomes really just one of trading off techniques that are proper responses to certain moves.
One of our viewers states, I don't roll my eyes. I sit back with popcorn, in fact, lightly salted and a bit buttered. that's typically what goes on. But how can we improve the discussion? I'm all for raising the bar, if you will, because I don't like these gotcha moments. I like conversations that are full of substance and less of a move like chess. In other words, I'm not trying to beat someone. I'm trying to share with someone something that they may not know, and they may be sharing with me something that I don't know. What are your thoughts?
No, I have a few things to say on that. Okay, I have this maxim that I live by when it comes to this kind of discussion, the great debate. Everybody gets the conversations they deserve, right? That's just rule number one. If you don't like the conversations that you're having, if you find, oh, I'm always talking to idiots and stuff like that, look at the common denominator in all those conversations. It's you, okay? If you find that everyone you talk to is an idiot, it's because you need to talk to other people, or you need to learn how to talk to other people so that they don't always strike you as idiots. But something's going on, wrong there, and it's probably you. And it's not that there's, you know, any shortage of idiots out there, but there's also a lot of people out there with whom you can have good conversations. And I don't waste my time talking to idiots. There's another saying. This is not one I came up with. This is an old saying. Never waste your time talking to an idiot, because onlookers will not be able to tell who the idiot is, right? So I mean, if you waste a lot of time talking to someone who's foolish, you know, they're going to play games, and then you're going to have to like either anticipate these games and point out that they're playing a game, and then you end up having a conversation about how to have a conversation. Or else you're going to fall into traps, right? And then you're going to end up looking foolish. But either way, you look like you're just wasting your time. And everyone's going, well, what are you wasting your time with this person for? So my feeling is that in keeping with these analogies we've been using about games, a conversation is a lot like playing chess or checkers, okay? There are people who, when you play chess with them, are serious-minded. They want you to play your best game. And they want to play their best game. And they want to win. But if they lose to you, they want to lose because you actually bested them. You played a better game, right? There are people who are sort of serious in a conversation, okay? And then there are people who they want to win no matter what. And there are people who will, as soon as you turn your head, will like move pieces on the board. There are people who will drum on the table and hum and try to distract you in a million ways so that you can't think straight. You know, there are people who cheat. There are people who bamboozle in a million ways, who use terminology they don't understand, who engage in rhetorical trickery. Would you play chess with someone like that? Well, maybe the first time if you didn't know they were like that. But once you found out that that's how they play chess, yeah, you'd say, you know, I'm done. I don't play chess or checkers with people like you. What is the point, right? There's simply no point. Or people who throw a tantrum and then, you know, knock the pieces, over or something like that, right? Or people who, no matter how the game turns out, declare victory and go around telling everybody that they won, who do their own scorekeeping, right? I don't talk to people like that, okay? And it's not because I think I'm better than them. It's that I have better things to do. It's not fun. It's not enjoyable. It's not interesting to me. People who do this and engage in these kinds of conversations with these kinds of people, a few things happen. First of all, you're going into hangouts and you're going onto message boards and in Facebook groups and things like that. And you're having conversations with people who you know are dishonest and who cheat. Right. And it doesn't matter what side of the argument you're on this, right? If by your lights there are people who are lying and cheating and distracting and obfuscating and throwing up smoke screens and that kind of stuff, and are not involved in serious discourse, right? They're not sincere, they're insincere, then what are you doing? You're basically trolling. You're there for sport. You're just there for recreation. It's a kind of amusement. Okay. Well, that's fine. That's okay as long as you know what you're doing. But then don't get frustrated and don't go complaining, right? You're slumming. If you're slumming, don't complain about the quality of the people that you're interacting with. You went into the slums and you know that you're in the slums. If you want to sort of not be in the slums, then don't go there. Go where there are better conversations to be had. That's my feeling. Just don't waste your time talking to people you don't think are worth talking to. And it's not necessarily an assessment of the other person, right? I mean, there are people who I think are not worth talking to on certain subjects who I wouldn't mind sitting down and having a meal with and talking to and befriending and having as a neighbor and hanging around with and going camping with and, sitting down and, you know, playing a game of cards with or, you know, going on a long drive and taking a hike with them and befriending them. But there's some people that on certain subjects I don't want to have a conversation with them about, right? And if you're involved in the great debate, you're here to have a certain kind of conversation. You get to control what kind of conversation you have, and you get to control who you're going to talk to. It's that simple. Everybody gets the kinds of conversations that they deserve. If you're not happy with the conversations that you're having, have conversations with different people. Or maybe change your conversational style. Maybe you're doing something wrong. Maybe you're the one who is dumbing down the conversation. And, you know, maybe you're the person crapping all over the chessboard.
Excellent.
That's to the point. I mean, that's good. I like that.
How can you not?
It makes me want to say perhaps.
But yes, well, you know, we might have a slight confession to make. There have been times when we've had conversations about what guests to be brought on the place. And sometimes, you know, we want to see if a person can kind of engage. And other times, well, you know, sometimes we want to demonstrate how this conversation doesn't go anywhere, and we'll be open to that. I mean, we don't try and bring those people back, but we're not, you know, sometimes we're not actually in the conversation to see that the conversation will be productive. But, and not that, but sometimes it can be hard, depending on the kind of controversy. I mean, can you imagine getting people together to talk about, say, abortion or gun control, who really want to have a conversation about this, who really want to appreciate and understand where each side is coming from and why this is so important to them and what seems so pertinent to them and how it might be possible, if we could, to find some sort of an approach to this issue that it gives as much as possible to both the values of both sides, if that can be done, in those issues. Now, I'm not so sure that that would be a practical solution for some of those issues and problems, but do we even try? I mean, sometimes it can be hard to find participants in a difficult or controversial discussion. And so the pickings can be slim, you know?
You know, sometimes in theism, this is really something that gets me aggravated, especially on shows. We've had so many theists come on the place, and my wife, sometimes she will kick me and say, wake up. And I don't want to be rude to anyone. I like to respect everyone, but doggone, sometimes you just want someone to provide something as simple as a hermeneutic. And I've asked, I don't know how many times, can you provide me with a hermeneutic that you used, that is, to come to the conclusions that you're coming to, namely concerning the Bible? And they will tell me all kinds of X, Y's, and Z's, but they don't have a hermeneutic. And lots of these people, especially in universalism, are really, you know, saying, well, in the Greek it says this or that, and they can't even read the Greek. And so I'm asking what kind of translation theory that they might be working from, and, you know, what is their text base that they are trying to suggest that this is the quote-unquote word of God. And the typical answer is, I don't know, but this is exactly what the Bible says or what God says. And so my question is that the same kind of landscape, in a sense, in atheism, Ozzie? Or is it a little bit better than what we see in theism?
Well, it's a little different, but I mean, there's no shortage of dogmatists among atheists. I mean, you just go onto Google Plus and wander over to one of the many, many atheism groups. There are these communities, right? You know, people set up a page, a community on Google Plus. You can set one up on anything, you know. And there's lots that are called atheism. And go in there and look at what people post there. You know, they'll post sometimes the most idiotic memes that are just, you know, these people will pat themselves on the back for being critical thinkers, and they'll post a meme that is just chock full of falsehoods about history, about Jesus, about, you know, about the history of Christianity or something like that. There's been no fact checking. You know, I have sometimes sort of gone to the trouble of saying, here's what's wrong with this meme. You know, this, all of these are just erroneous. Like, where is the critical thinking? You know, where is the fact checking? You know, where's the skepticism here? There isn't any, right? What there is just a group of people trying to malign another group of people. So there's no shortage of bigotry and dogmatism and irrationality and lack of skepticism among atheists. A lot of people think that if you tumble out of your faith, you've suddenly got a PhD in critical thinking. And that is a conceit. That is just laughable, right? You don't suddenly become smarter just because you abandon what by your lights is now a mistake that you once believed in. You don't become a better critical thinker just because you've abandoned your faith, shook off your faith. But a lot of people think that if I shook off my faith, it's because I had to have been a more critical thinker. Well, yes, it's true. You know, to the extent that you now are able to see flaws in what you used to believe, but that's not systematic. You're not suddenly, you know, a better critical thinker. You're just now able to apprehend errors in some perhaps narrow domain that you didn't see before. But you could have all kinds of other blind spots even within that domain. So I'm not someone who believes that that atheists are on average more skeptical, more rational, and less dogmatic. No, not on average. I don't think that's true. I think that there are some, but I mean, I wouldn't put money down if someone said, "Who do you think is more skeptical and more rational, a theist or an atheist?" I would not put my money on either one. And a lot of atheists, a lot of my fellow atheists, would just be shocked to hear that, but. You know, I don't see the evidence of it, right? I mean, just go over to some of these communities, right? These are just hotbeds of anti-theistic bigotry and irrationality and a lack of critical thinking. So there's tons of that. So where I think it's a little different is that for a lot of theists, the stakes are extremely high. Their theism, depending on what they believe, if they belong to the Abrahamic faiths, they believe in heaven and hell very often. They believe in, you know, salvation and damnation. They believe that morality inheres in a God, and without a God, we're just free of our moorings, morally speaking. Life is evacuated of meaning, purpose, value, and significance without a God. And so I think the stakes are a lot higher, and people can be a little bit more strident. In particular cases, about what they're talking about. So I think if the stakes are higher, that makes a difference. You know, the higher you think the stakes are, the more it's going to matter, and probably the more strident you're going to be on a question. Whereas if you think, well, you know, there's no God, well, then this and that, this particular question, that particular question don't matter so much anymore. Then maybe you just think that there are pernicious social effects attended upon having religious beliefs, right? And for some people, they think religion is the great evil. You know, it's not the love of money that's the root of all evil. It's the love of God that is the root of all evil, according to some people, right? And for those people, they can be just as bad as the worst of fundamentalists. You know, I mean, there are people out there who think that religiosity is literally a form of insanity that needs treatment, and that needs to be, you know, not just, people don't need to be disabused of falsehoods. They need to be treated, and we need to forbid expressions of religion and stuff like that. That I think is really unfortunate and just as dogmatic as the forces that they're opposing. My thought there.
I have two questions for Ozzy here. One is, I certainly don't think it's the cure-all and the perfect environment, but I think I have found that I have liked settling more into the collegiate environment, talking to people who have more made it a living to seek, to teach, to instruct, particularly if they've had to deal with people of a variety of different opinions and they've needed to learn how as a teacher. So I found that I've enjoyed many times the discussions I'm capable of getting into when I'm, you know, in more of a college environment with professors. Maybe that's just my own bias, though. You know, I don't know. But so, I mean, I found that to be better. But the other question, I was just curious if you had any similar thoughts to that. But the question I have is this. And I don't know the answer to this, so it is an honest question. Suppose the scenario is this. I could steal $200 from somebody who would never miss it, wouldn't know that I took it. 4 billion years from now, there's no God. What difference does it make? Now, part of me wants to say that, why does it have to make a difference in 4 billion years? Isn't it good enough that it makes a difference in the psychological lines I'm willing to cross while I am alive, which strikes me as being any time I'm willing to be dishonest, I am drawing for myself a perimeter that permits me to behave in a particular way. So I don't know that 4.3 billion more years on the Earth has to make a difference. But I'm curious, what do you say that, that there are certain moral arguments one might argue that if it doesn't make a difference in 4.3 billion years from now, then how can we claim that there's any morality in it?
That always strikes me as, you know, hey, you know, what's the point of going to sleep tonight? You're going to be tired tomorrow night. You know, like, yeah, so the reason I'm going to sleep tonight is because I'm tired tonight. It's not because it's going to cure me of sleepiness. So it doesn't matter what's going to happen 4 billion years from now. One of the things that the scenario you started with, like, you know, just imagine that someone is stealing from you. And you don't know it, and you're not in a position to find out. I mean, there's sort of a classic thought experiment. Imagine that you own a collection, you own a priceless collection of something. You've been collecting, I don't know, baseball cards, something that's very valuable to you. Might not be valuable to other people, but it's valuable to you. You've been collecting these things for years and years, and you keep them in a locked or safe room in your house for years and years. And you have a friend who comes over, and unbeknownst to you, he has cracked your safe. And every day he visits you, and while you step off to, you know, go fetch tea or something like that, he slips in there and he takes a little bit of your collection every single day. Now, let's just say that you have completed your collection. Okay. And you have sort of looked at it and examined it and played with your collection, and you're done doing that. You still value and prize your collection. You still own it. It's still yours. It's still a source of pride and satisfaction that you have, you know, completed this collection, but you never visit it anymore. You're just satisfied that it's there in that room and it's complete, and you're never going to go in it again. You don't even intend to go look at it again. Okay. And your friend is ripping you off. Okay. And, you know, has the person stolen from you? Well, of course, has literally stolen from you, but you're never going to find out. So what's the consequence? You know, like if you're a consequentialist, what's wrong with this, right? You can even imagine that you fully intend to will it to this person upon your death, so that he's just ending up with your collection prematurely, right? You can even imagine that in the thought experiment. Okay, what's wrong with it? Well, what's wrong with it is it says something about the person, right? I am not a consequentialist. I think consequences are important to morality, but so is the concept of duty. So is deontology, the sense of obligation. Important sense and intentions matter. But it's not just narrow consequences. So scenarios that say, well, let's imagine a person doing what we would think is wrong, but we eliminate all the negative consequences, right? There's no, like, the person just doesn't feel like a victim. They're never going to find out that they've been ripped off, right? Where's the harm, right? The kind of ethical system that I subscribe to is not deontology, and it's not consequentialism. It's called virtue ethics or virtue-based ethics. And for me, right and wrong has to do with the cultivation of a certain kind of character, becoming a certain kind of person, cultivating what are called the virtues. And a person who would do that to you has a very obviously not cultivated certain kinds of virtues of solidarity and openness and honesty and loyalty. And friendliness, and there are all kinds of virtues, they have not cultivated these things, and it tells me something about their character. And what it tells me is that if they're willing to steal in these circumstances, that what they are is dishonest and disloyal. This is part of their character, and if they're willing to do it here, there's a very good chance that they will do it in circumstances where it would matter, where it really would victimize me. Okay. I think there is actually something wrong with such a person who does that. Even if you can't point to the harm that it's doing, the harm that it's doing in any particular case doesn't matter. You can do wrong even when there is no victim, when no one is harmed. Just as you can do right even when no one benefits. Think of all the times where you tried to do the right thing and it didn't work. You didn't help anybody. You might even have hurt somebody while trying to do the right thing. We still honor that person. We still recognize, well, that was a great thing to do. Why? It says something about the person's character, right? The intentions really very often trump the consequences, right? Now, we're all responsible for the predictable consequences of our actions. Not the consequences, but the predictable consequences of our actions. You're not responsible for consequences that nobody could have predicted. But you are responsible for the predictable consequences of your actions. But there are also predictable consequences of your actions with respect to what that says about you. Why don't we like a person who's a habitual liar? It's, well, you can't trust such a person, right? It doesn't matter if they're telling you white lies, okay? But now contrast that with a case with a person who lies to you all day long one day. All day long, this person lies to you. But they're lying to you because they love you and they're trying to get you to your birthday party, a surprise birthday party where all your friends are going to be there. And that person lies to you up and down all day long. At the end of the day, when you find out that the person's been BSing you, you're probably going to hug them and thank them and say, oh, I can't believe you did this, right? Why? Because there are times when lying is a good thing. I think there are times when lying is morally obligatory, right? Because the intentions matter and it tells you something about the character. So you can't even say that a person who is a liar has a bad character. It depends how they're lying and why they're lying, yeah, right? Infidelity. I can even imagine cases of infidelity where it's moral to be infidelitous. You know, consider a person who is married in a hopeless, loveless marriage, right? Or perhaps with someone who has some kind of infirmity and, you know, they can't make love to their spouse or something like that. I can even imagine a situation where the person wants to remain with that person, needs a sexual outlet. You know, I'm thinking of Stephen Hawking, for instance. He and his wife had a kind of weird relationship like this. I mean, these situations are obviously going to be uncommon, but you can even sort of contrive situations where even an infidelity can actually be a good thing, right? Literally lying and withholding information about having an affair, right? You can actually contrive situations where even that would be morally acceptable and morally preferable to simply suffering a life of sexual frustration, dissatisfaction, resentment, and all of that that would poison your relationship. I think that there, even in circumstances like that, you know, it can happen. So I think that the scenarios that we're talking about here with respect to morality, where you say, you imagine away all the bad consequences, you can still point to, despite there being no bad consequences, that there's something wrong about what the person's doing. And even in situations where there there is a lot of good that results, they might actually still be doing a bad thing. It's not as simple as looking at the consequences.
With the development of good character, there will be times when in this particular circumstance, the outcome was just not what we had hoped for. But in the long run, I do think that the person who develops character is going to minimize that sort of thing. And a person who's willing to corrupt their character is a person who I think is going to end up very often overstepping the bounds in a way that really does more maximize that kind of thing. Although I see it more as a character thing, much like you do, that the consequences, as you say, predictably are important, but the character, the integrity, the motive, the intent, even the concern, the care, and the love, the celebration of the dignity of the other person, these are very valuable and important things. And when we compromise those values, we harm ourselves. We harm and we make ourselves the kind of a person who's capable of harming others in ways we would never own. But I also appreciate that there are some scenarios that I'm not the judge, and I'm thankful I live in a circumstance, a situation where I don't have to deal with too many conundrums.
I want to read another thought experiment, if you will. This would be by Nichols and Stitch. This was presented in 2001. And let me preface it by stating that several leading epistemological theories predict that getting subjects to think about possibilities in which their beliefs are mistaken should make them less willing to attribute knowledge to themselves or others. And this was one of the thought experiments that was put together. It goes like this. Mike is a young man visiting the zoo with his son. And when they come to the zebra cage, Mike points to the animal and says, "That's a zebra." Mike is right. It is a zebra. However, as the older people in his community know, there are lots of ways that people can be tricked into believing things that aren't true. Indeed, the older people in the community know that it's possible that zoo authorities could cleverly disguise mules to look like zebras, and people viewing the animals would not be able to tell the difference. If the animal that Mike called a zebra had really been such a cleverly painted mule, Mike still would have thought that it was a zebra. Does Mike really know that the animal is a zebra, or does he only believe that it is? What are your thoughts, Ozzy?
That reminds me of another thought experiment, actually. Well, the argument there is, the point of that, it's a lot like those Getty counter examples. You have a person who has a belief, they have a justification for the belief happens to be true. But there are certain other considerations which knowing about those considerations, or if they knew about those considerations, would undermine or should undermine their confidence in that belief. We were talking about the cow in the field example as a Getty counterexample last week. There's another one called the barn example. Okay, let's imagine that there's somebody and they look on the hill and they see a barn. And they form the belief that that's a barn, you know, it's a real barn, okay? As they're driving by, they look over on a hill and they see a barn in a field, okay? But unbeknownst to them, this particular town that they're driving through is no ordinary town. This is a town that Hollywood likes to use for films and film sets. And they routinely erect these facades that look like three-dimensional structures, like a saloon and a barn and stuff like that. But in fact, it's just like a flat surface that's painted, and it looks, you know, as you're going by, like the real thing. Okay. Now, what do you say what would we say about the following situation? A person is driving through this town. They know that this is what goes on in this town, and they see a structure that they've never seen before. Okay, they're driving down a road they've never been driven down, and they go, "Oh, there's a barn. It looks like a barn." Okay, let's say that it is a barn. They believe it's a barn, and they have a reason to think it's a barn. That is, it looks exactly like a barn. Okay, they have a justified true belief. Okay, doesn't the fact that they know that in this town structures get erected that look like three-dimensional structures, like barns and saloons and stuff like that, but aren't, shouldn't that worry them? Shouldn't that sort of mitigate their confidence? Should that not militate against their confidence? Well, yeah, it should. I mean, that should strongly worry you, right? These are things that they're sometimes called undercutters. They don't necessarily defeat your belief, right? And vitiate your knowledge, okay? But they should absolutely undermine your confidence. Your confidence should just scale right down, such that even if you do know, given your awareness of that fact about being in that situation, in that particular town where this goes on, you have no business claiming that you know. Even if you do know, you have no business saying that you know, because there are mitigating factors that, once you are apprised of them, and you are apprised of them, you know what goes on in this town, you should no longer be trusting the evidence of your senses the way you normally would if you were in a different town looking at what you take to be a barn. So that's how I see those kinds of situations. That's why I think, I mean, I said last time that I don't think justification is an ingredient in knowledge, in the definition of knowledge. It's important. It's important for the purposes of persuading other people. It's also important for the purposes of setting the level on your own confidence. And And even in a situation where you have a belief, you have a justification for your belief, and your belief is true, and you satisfy all the three conditions for the JTB definition of knowledge, for that particular definition of knowledge, there are other things that you can have in your belief set, like the belief that I'm in a town where these kinds of facades get erected, where if that's one of your beliefs, that should shatter your confidence. Yeah. It doesn't mean you don't know what you think you know. You might know it, but you are no longer in a position to assert that you know. The conditions for public assertability, for asserting with confidence that you know, are no longer satisfied. Right. And you need to scale back your confidence, and you should not be asserting that you know. So you can know things and not be in a position to assert it.
You know, you could even make this a little more interesting by saying, what if there's a real barn up on the hill that's actually been used in this Hollywood set, and you've actually been to the barn, you've been in it, you know that it is a real barn, but unknown to you, the barn has since collapsed, and so they have gone up and erected the facade so as to be able to continue the picture without actually having erected a real barn. You know, you got scenarios like this that truly complicated, because you're actually in a place that violates the normative rules, and you know that. And so there's no end to the potential issues going on with all those.
Well, in that case, though, Bob, the person has a justified false belief, because they are, in fact, not looking at a barn. They're looking at the facade of a barn. So One of the conditions isn't satisfied. Right, the truth condition, the metaphysical truth condition, is not satisfied. So only two of the three conditions.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's a justified false belief. So that, you know, ex hypothesi, by definition here, under this definition of knowledge, they wouldn't know it, even if they had excellent reasons for thinking that that it is in fact a barn. What I think is a more interesting scenario is a scenario where you're driving through this town, but you don't know that this goes on, that Hollywood does this. Okay, so there is a barn. You believe it's a barn, so you have a true belief. You have a justification for thinking it's a barn because it looks for all the world like a barn. But all around you are structures that you thought were a house and a saloon and a grain silo, and none of them were. Okay, so your record of true beliefs is terrible. Everything you thought was a silo and a barn and a farmhouse, all that, they were all wrong. And then finally you're looking at a barn that is really a barn, and you think that's a barn, just like you thought those other things were real. But this time you happen to be right, okay? And you have no idea that you've been wrong all along, but now you're finally right. You are now coincidentally right. Would that be knowledge, right, in a condition like that, right? And I would argue, well, actually, here you're relying on a reliable process, but your reliable process is operative in a situation where, objectively speaking, in that circumstances, its reliability is crap. Yeah, right. It's kind of like, hey, you know, vision is a reliable belief-forming process, right? My visual experiences are ordinarily reliable. But you can put me in a visual environment, you know, like the Hall of Mirrors or something like that, where I simply cannot trust the evidence of my senses, right? I can't trust my eyes. Here is a place where my eyes are lying to me all the time. And you can actually be driving through a town where – the evidence of your senses is not reliable, but you think it is. So you're relying on a reliable belief-forming process, but you find yourself in a situation that is atypical, where the norms, as you said, are now violated. And so consequently, you wouldn't be in a position to know that you need to scale back your confidence. And so you would be confidently asserting that this is a barn, just like you confidently asserted that that was a grain silo and that that was a saloon and that was a farmhouse. This time you happen to be right. Would you call that knowledge, though, in the one instance where you happen to be right? Then it gets a little bit tricky.
Yeah. You don't want to go to Escher, New York.
That's right.
That's true, Bob.
You know, walk it upside down or something.
Now, once again, Westerners, these are the percentages. 30% of them thought that that Mike really knew. 69 only believed. South Asians, 50% really knew. 50% only believes. And so it's interesting to see the dynamic here. Once again, what are your thoughts on why these South Asians are coming to different conclusions than the Westerners?
Well, in my view, if you're talking to people of different, I mean, were all these questions asked in English to people who
were
from different ethnic backgrounds? And so these were people who are from different ethnic backgrounds, but who are all fluent speakers of English, right?
To my knowledge.
Okay, yeah, because of course, if you're asking them in a different language, then
the equivalent
word for knowledge in another language might actually mean something very different. You have cognate words, but in fact, they mean something quite different. Yeah, I guess my feeling there is if they are in fact native, either native speakers of English, or fluent speakers of English, but have different ethnic backgrounds, then clearly there's something in their ethnic background, something else in their belief set. As a result of the rest of what they believe, as a result of their
it's possible baggage. In the culture, it's possible that in their subculture, that there are objects that they deal with that are more a model for certain different scenarios that other subgroups wouldn't be a part of. I mean, you've seen the two lines that are the same length, but one of them have the V in different directions, and many people will perceive the lines to be of different length, but that's different in different cultures. But it's at least the theory is that there are ways in which this resembles certain things they actually see that unbeknownst to them, the brain is sort of making that comparison and doing the size analysis for them without their realizing because of things they actually run into in their culture. It's not as if certain people are genetically somehow wired so differently that they have this perceptual deficit versus that perceptual deficit. I would first want to look for something that had something within their perceptual subculture that lent to the difference. At least that'd be my first suspicion.
Yeah, my sense would be that there's something in there in the constellation of their belief set that informs their judgment of what constitutes knowledge differently than people in a different who have a different constellation of beliefs.
Of the problems that could be engaged.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Well, I mean, I'll give you an example. I mean, ask a philosopher if such and such a situation constitutes knowledge, you'll typically get a very different answer from if you ask someone who's untutored in philosophy. Why? Well, because philosophers are used to a rather more narrow and restrictive definition of knowledge, a different conception of knowledge. Usually they're talking about empirical knowledge, first of all. And so they have a tendency to sort of say that something is knowledge under rather more restrictive conditions. And more likely to say that something isn't knowledge than the average person, right? Because for a lot of people, the average person, knowledge just very often just means awareness. Like if I say, hey, do you know Bob? I'm just asking you, are you aware that there's a person named Bob? Hey, do you know Mark Twain? I'm not asking you, do you have a justified true belief about the existence of Mark Twain? I'm asking you, have you heard of Mark Twain? Yeah. Right? And so for a lot of people, knowledge is just nothing like justified true belief, but something much more nebulous. And I don't say nebulous in a disparaging way. I just mean it's the boundaries are fuzzier and it's a more inclusive concept. So I would predict that different ethnic groups are going to evaluate these situations differently and conclude differently about whether or not something constitutes knowledge. I would not confidently predict who would do what because I'd have to know a lot about these different ethnic groups and what informs their linguistic intuitions, and I don't have that information. So the only way to do that is to actually perform these experiments, find out which ethnic groups have a tendency to say what their linguistic intuitions are, and then try to suss out what is going on in their ethnic background that leads them to form reach different conclusions about what constitutes knowledge.
One of the first along those lines, and this might be a bit of a stretch, that really opened me up to that real problem is that when I read, I wish I could remember the author's name, it was Deborah something, I think, she wrote she wrote an article that I read called, you know, argumentation as sociability. And she was studying some Jewish subcultures where she was of the opinion that in that culture, there was a certain amount of hostile argumentation that was a complimentary. It was a way of saying, you are a worthy person for me to get involved in a tug of war with discussion. And there was almost a compliment involved in the fact that I'm going to give you a verbal gruff, you know, and it was, you know, argument as sociability was the title of the, yeah. And it was an interesting article. And I think she made the point that in that particular subculture, this was part of the rite of passage in which people felt accepted in the culture. Whereas in some other culture, you start giving people verbal gruff and they're going, what's your problem?
let's move it a little bit along. This is wonderful what we're getting into, but I want to cover a little bit more territory tonight, if that's all right with you guys. Oftentimes in the great debate, what happens, a lot of people are arguing over, let's say, whether something is objective truth or subjective truth. Let me read this concerning what Ronald Dworkin had to say on objective truth. He asked the question, is there any objective truth, or must we finally accept at bottom, in the end, philosophically speaking, there is no real or objective or absolute or foundational or fact of the matter or right answer truth about anything, that even our most confident convictions about what happened in the past or what the universe is made of or who we are or what is beautiful or who is wicked are just our convictions, just conventions, just ideologies, just badges of power, just the rules of language games we choose to play, just the product of our irrepressible disposition to deceive ourselves that we have discovered out there in some external, objective, timeless, mind-independent world what we have actually invented ourselves out of instinct, imagination, and culture. So what are your thoughts on what he's suggesting concerning objective truth?
Well, I don't like to distinguish between subjective and objective truth. I mean, we can, but it usually doesn't mean what people would like it to mean. I mean, for me, truth is just truth. There's no such thing as capital T truth. There's no such thing as absolute truth. Sticking the word absolute in front of the word truth doesn't mean anything to me. You know, truth is just what is the case, right? Whatever the case is. Independently of how we would know it, I mean, just whatever is the case, that's the truth. Okay, the reality is all that is the case. Okay, and truth is a predicate that we apply to sentences and beliefs and statements that express a proposition that tries to describe reality. Now, how you establish that something is true, that is a big question. That's a different question. But you know, what do we mean by truth? Truth, I think, is you just. It's when the map describes the territory properly, right? It's really nothing more than that. It's that simple and primitive a notion. Now, so in that sense, truth is always an objective question. It's always what is actually the case, right? Irrespective of what you think. But sometimes our beliefs or sentences are about states of affairs that have nothing to do with a subject. And then sometimes a belief or a proposition or a sentence expresses a proposition that is about a subject. For instance, consider this. If I say I'm hungry now or I'm in pain, okay, well, what makes that the case? Makes that statement true that I'm in pain? If I say I'm in pain, my elbow hurts. What makes the statement that my elbow hurts is that there is in me a subjective mental experience of discomfort, right? There's a subjective fact. There's a fact that is only accessible to me. That's not equally accessible to every competent observer. You can infer that I'm in pain, but you don't experience the pain. Your access, your evidence of my being in pain is different than my evidence of being in pain. Okay. So there are subjective facts. There are facts that inhere in a subject. That, but if there were no subjects, that, you know, if there were no people, if there were no subjects, if there wasn't a, if there were no beings capable of having first person subjective experiences, there'd be no pains, there'd be no hunger, there'd be no pride, there'd be no shame, there'd be no tickles and itches and lust and disgust and all the rest of it, right? Those things simply would not exist, right? So there are certain facts that are intrinsically subjective. That is, they are facts that arise out of the very existence of a subject. But then there are facts like there are the fact that Everest is the tallest mountain on the earth. Okay. That's true independently of anybody. That's just the case, even if there are no people. I mean, that was true before there were people. You know, Everest presumably was the tallest mountain before humans evolved, right? Maybe I'm wrong about that, but let's for the sake of the argument, let's say that it was already, or that the moon was here before there were people, right? You know, that's a fact, even though there's nobody here to it. Nobody could establish that, right, necessarily. There are facts that are objective in the sense that they have nothing to do with subjects, and then there are facts that have everything to do with the subject, right? And so there, I think we can speak of subjective truth and objective truths. The truths that refer to subjective facts are subjective truths, and the truths that refer to non-subjective facts, right, objective facts or intersubjectively available facts, those are the objective truths. I mean, really, those are just truths. It's just that the facts in question determine whether we want to preface the word truth with the word subjective or objective. That would be my feeling.
Would you think that, though, in some way, the question that Dr. Jones was asking, that I would totally agree with you, what you said about, just this simple objective facts, such as, you know, as you gave that great example, you know, the moon here before any human beings here. But is one thing for something to just simply be the case, and it's another thing for us to assess that it actually is the case. And so this, I think, kind of blurs those lines. Maybe even goes back to that village with all those facades, you know. There are problems in understanding just what is the case, but I think, you know, the likelihood that everything that I know just has happened to work out, with the odds being that I'm wrong about everything, you know, it just seems to me that we're now getting ridiculous to the point where to what degree I may be wrong about everything is irrelevant to the meaning of life or the purposes for which we believe anything to actually be true. I do think it's an interesting thing to kind of fetter out, but one of the things I learned just in trying to get to know myself better is that I've certainly learned that reality is something other than what I perceive it to be. But you know what? I have never been able to live in anything other than my own reality.
I think that's equivocating on the word reality. That's,
you know, yes, it is. It definitely is. But yeah. And we use the word for the same. So it'd probably be more accurate to say the reality is different from my perception, but I live in my perception.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Our access to the way to say it is like this. You know, we reality is whatever is the case, but what we have is our perception, and so. Everyone has. There's only one reality. No, we aren't all living in different realities, but we all live in different models of reality, right? It's like having a map, right? Right. There's one territory, but everyone has their own map of the territory. That's your belief set is your map, right? That you're creating. You're creating a map, right? You're constantly updating and revising your map. You're changing your map. You're erasing it here. You're changing a line there. You're adding some details there. You're discovering an incongruity in two parts of your map, and you go, "Oh, wait a minute, this doesn't work. Something's got to give, but I don't know what." You know, there's all kinds of things that are going on here. We, in other words, we don't live in the map. We live in the territory. Okay, but the only representation we have of the territory is the map, right? So I think that's the way to do it. It's kind of like, you know, you're at sea and you're navigating, and when you're at sea, everything in every direction looks the same, right? But you've got this chart, and the chart is what you rely on, and the chart allows you to make predictions about what you're going to see next, whether you're going to find an island, or whether you're going to find, you know, just more open water, or, you know, whatever. And so we don't live in different realities. We live in one reality. That's what reality means. Reality is that which is the case, whatever the hell the case is, whatever it might turn out to be, independently of what we believe. But we certainly do live in our beliefs. We live in our belief set, right? Our belief set is how we apprehend reality. It is through our beliefs that we apprehend reality. Our beliefs are our apprehension of reality, literally, right? Your belief is what you take to be the case, as opposed to what is the case. And that's why we have to distinguish between perception and reality. Because if perception and reality are not to be distinguished, if perception of reality is the same as reality, then you couldn't be mistaken in your perception, right? There'd be no such thing as a mistake. So
one of the hardest mistakes, or one of the hardest lessons to learn while growing up is, and for some people this is much more of a traumatic experience, is to actually discover that perception and reality are not identical. For some people, they've counted on it so long that I don't know. I could be wrong, but I get the impression that the more educated a person is, the more likely it is that they will make that discovery early on and actually incorporate it into their critical thinking. But the less educated a person is, the more they may be of the opinion that what they perceive is what is the case, and that can be difficult. Indeed, I think there's actually a certain level of cognitive development for the child that they have to reach before that concept can even begin to make sense to them.
Bob, you and I were talking on FaceTime. We all always do, it seems like, at least two or three times a day. But you made various comments, and I would like to read at least a couple of them tonight and have you, you know, just elaborate a bit. One would be something that I think makes some sense here. You stated, people who devote much time and effort to studying something often come to believe that the perspective they have acquired is the essential key to understanding the topic.
Yeah, you're writing down things that I say. I've noticed that like they say, to a hammer, all problems look like a nail. You know, I first came to that opinion when I was having serious problems as a teenager. I was constantly passing out and in school, and in fact the school nurse was wondering, are you on drugs or something? And I went through a period of time from about the time I was 16 until about 25 where two or three times a week I would just simply pass out, and just I'm just total exhausted, and I'm sometimes then hyperventilate and what have you, and it was just a horrible time. Well, at first I went to a guy who was a former psychiatrist and an endocrinologist, and he had left psychiatry for reasons I don't necessarily know, but he'd become an endocrinologist, I suspect for reasons where he saw some problems that were suspected to be psychiatric problems that he saw really at the root, not the lack of some sort of psychotropic drug, but rather some endocrinological problem contributing to it. Anyway, he became convinced that it was endocrinological. And I went to a family doctor who thought that it was really just psychological. And I'm thinking, you know, the medical doctor, who's just the family doctor, he's coming to this conclusion because he knows it doesn't fit within his medical practice. And the endocrinologist is dismissing the possible psychological because something about the way I was behaving struck him as, in fact, the first thing he tries me for is hypoglycemia and stuff like this. Later, I think it is, you know, who knows? It just seems to me that it practically worked out that it was my dealing with a lot of the traumatic stresses of some of the emotional conditions I was living under. In growing up in that home, that later when I was able to resolve those issues with my own dignity intact, that it fell apart. And I think that the real answer was that it was psychological. But I noticed that in many times when I went to various different specialists trying to help me with this problem, that it seemed that they were always convinced that somehow their area of specialty was the real key to understanding, you know, what my problems seemed to have been. And I think that I began to generally notice that that would be true, that when I can study something well and I can begin to see how what I know is a metaphor for other things that I see, I can be deceived into thinking that it truly is a very workable metaphor. Whereas if I were to study something else, I might discover other ideas for which there's a better goodness of fit. So I do think that much study, as useful as it can be, can deceive us into thinking that the clarity that it appears to give to us in assessing other situations is really borrowing metaphors from our knowledge instead of perhaps some better metaphor that we would that we could adopt if we just knew more about some other area. And so that's why I said that. That's what I was thinking of. I was actually thinking of that experience of childhood and how I think that being a real expert who has something to say is not always as easy as it might seem, you know, and particularly if you can look at an issue and see so much in it that you can resonate with and see, it can be seductive in a deceptive way, I think.
One more. I want to read this quickly because we have people here in the studio who might want to ask a couple of questions. But you also stated, and I think that you were talking in the context of people living, if you will, in paradigms. You said people who focus too much on righteousness inevitably become self-righteous. That's a great point. So too, people who focus too much on rational argumentation become self-rational. They become so deeply invested in the hard work of thinking already undertaken that they become well nigh incapable of seeing their own lack of rational thinking. But wow, they see those who disagree with them as being irrational for no better reason than that these people merely have a different paradigm.
Yeah, wow. I remember saying that.
I like that a lot.
I think that
you like that, Ozzy?
Yeah, I more than like it. I love it. I think that people make a fetish of rationality. I mean, you know, my background's in philosophy. I self-identify as a rationalist and a skeptic. You know, but I mean, people get fetishistic about it. But I'd like to hear Bob elaborate on this more before I say anything else.
I think life is far more complex than just the ability to think things through. As useful as it is, I think that there's a sense in which you should always bring the right tool to the job. But just because you have – this is very similar to the earlier statement. Just because you've learned how to use a particular tool very well doesn't mean and you seem to get results doesn't mean it is really the best tool. I started out years ago doing some guitar repair, and I understood the guitar well enough to know its construction, its structure, what needed to be done for a guitar to be properly set up and what makes the guitar truly playable and what its problems can be. I had a pretty good sense of that. But when I first started doing guitar repair, I was just using whatever tools I could get a hold of. And it wasn't until I actually spent a few thousand dollars on getting tools made specifically for working on guitars. Oh, how much easier it was to work on the guitars with those tools, you know. So that as useful as the tool of rationality is, I think that some people can over rely on it. And the first time I think I became aware of that, I don't know why, but as I was growing up, I would observe certain things and ask myself, how does this apply to the rest of life? And I remember when I was about 15, I was pretty good at karate, and I got to know a guy named Larry Walters, who was a judo guy. He was amazing. He was really good at it. And he was interested in studying karate, and I was interested in looking at judo. And I didn't have the money to study judo, and he was a judo teacher. So we made a deal. I would teach him karate, he would teach me judo, and he didn't charge me, you know. So that's how I paid for my judo lessons. We had this one guy who came in. He was kind of big, very big, and he was very strong, and it was very hard to throw this guy. And it was very easy for him to throw other people because of how big and strong he was. But he was not learning the technique. because he was relying on his strengths. But as time went on, the rest of us are discovering the leverage, the technique, the pressure points. And we got to the point where it was getting more difficult for him to toss us around. And we were getting to the point where we could toss him about in ways he just wasn't used to being tossed around. But he relied so much on what he was strong with that he never really allowed himself to develop these techniques that worked in other kinds of situations. He eventually quit, and he never really became very good at judo simply because he relied on something he was very good at, but that wasn't really the proper tool for this particular context. And so I think that's a lot of where that had to do. Very helpful to be, thoughtful, rational, and this, that. But I'll tell you what, when your wife is crying because of something that's hurting her feelings, that's not the time to discuss whether or not this is a reasonable assessment her feelings, her perspective, her reality, and the process by which she is going to resolve this may not even include seeing the matter differently or whatever. Who knows? But there's just the right tool for the job. And I think that some people who are very good at some kinds of thinking tend to invest their lives in just doing that. And it's sad.
Ozzy, you wanted to comment on what I read.
Yeah, well, I take a slightly different view of what Bob was talking about. I don't think that you can go through life just sort of dispassionately assessing circumstances, but you do have to do that. You have to sort of look upon, reflect, and apply the norms of good reasoning, scientific values, skepticism to what you believe and to as much of your life as possible, including things like how you respond emotionally to people, like when your wife is crying and stuff like that. Because, I'm going to confess something here. I'm someone who is, as I get older and older, find myself more and more emotional, more and more comfortable emoting. I used to not be that way, but I don't know what it is. But as I've gotten older, I'm more comfortable crying over a movie. And there are certain circumstances, certain people in my life who, when I will tell a story, describe a movie or a novel, I don't know what it is, but talking to these people, I just feel tears welling up. I get choked up. It doesn't happen to everybody. I'm not sort of this blubbering fool, but there are certain people who I don't know what it is about them, but when I'm talking to them, I get choked up. And I sort of feel like I'm getting more comfortable with, my emotions. I feel more comfortable expressing them. But that's something to be reflected upon because it can be inappropriate. You can actually be emoting it in ways that are inappropriate, to the wrong people. I caught myself doing it recently. Like, what the hell am I doing? I'm actually imposing upon a person here with my emotional states. As, you can emotionally blackmail a person quite by accident without meaning to. And I mean, your emotions are I learned this from Bob in an episode of The Unconventional Pastor. It was one of the best ones I ever saw, where he talked about how emotions are really you at your most honest. They are the expressions of what you actually think and feel. Your emotions don't lie to you. but that doesn't mean that you have to abide by your emotions, right? But you have to heed what's going on there. So I'm not someone who thinks that, there are different ways of knowing. There's an emotional way of knowing and there's an intellectual way of knowing. I don't see it that way. And I don't think Bob was suggesting anything that way, but I think a lot of people will come away with that message. And that's not a message that I would endorse. But there is an analogous case to self-righteousness, this self-rational. I kind of like that term. I'd like to tweak it somehow.
I'm thinking of my father, to be honest with you, in that statement. And while I was growing up, I didn't know anything about Asperger's, and my father was never really diagnosed with that. But as I look back at it, I think it would not surprise me if he could have been. But my dad was created in an environment that was emotionally destructive, and he always came at all of the circumstances and situations, in a sense, quite disgusted with the fact that people were not thinking it through rationally. And he had no sense of values or feelings that people had. And he seemed to have no patience with the fact that children kind of need to grow up before they become adults, you know, and we were just, to him, inept adults. It was insufferable in many ways and very damaging. It took me a long time to kind of come to a sense of my own dignity I was still 27 and a real mess. I think I was like 28 before I was able to even really consider the fact that what I thought about myself based upon the way my father treated me might actually be an unfair assessment of myself. And it was just play games. I have one sister who would always say this, and when she said it, it really rang true with me. She said, "Our parents did not raise us; they lowered us." And part of the way they did it, they were not the kind. I mean, they didn't beat me, you know, to the end of the my senses or within an inch of my life. But the criticism, the analysis, the relying upon the kind of problem solving techniques that they did were just overused, and what was really needed, you know, how about just a hug? I have no memory of ever being hugged by I do recall one time when he did hug me. But, you know, there's no holding his hand or sitting on his lap or talking to him about a problem I'm having or anything like that. In fact, when I got interested in the guitar, even as a young kid, I deliberately said, I am not going to play my guitar in front of my dad because I don't want to hear his opinion about my playing. He's one of a person I would think of as kind of self-rational, you know.
Let me break in and share one of the comments that was just made. They're so gentle. They're talking about you two guys. It's almost infuriating sometimes. I was so glad when they got mad in that other show. Humanity. Really? What's going on here?
Well, I don't know. sometimes we sort of see eye to eye, sometimes we don't.
Gotta find the right trigger.
Yeah. There was something I wanted to add though about self-righteousness. And sort of self-rationalism or rationality, however you want to call it. There are people who I think become so enamored of the idea of skepticism and rationality and logic that they fetishize it. And what I mean by that is they become allergic to certain other concepts. They get the words like faith and belief make them flee. You know, I'll give you an example. You'll hear people say, "I don't believe in evolution. I accept evolution. I accept the fact of evolution, or I accept the evidence for evolution." What the hell do you think a belief is other than accepting something is true, right? what is a belief other than accepting or affirming a proposition to be true? That's what a belief is. So of course I believe evolution, and I believe it because I think I have good reasons. But right, but there are people who are allergic to the word belief. Why? Because the word belief, they think, belongs to the discourse of religiosity.
Right.
And, you know, and the same with faith. Oh, faith means blind faith. It means faith in the very teeth of contrary evidence, right? So there are people out there who imagine that and will boast, they will say, all of my beliefs are grounded in reasons and evidence. Really? All of them? You know, I got to say, as someone who studied philosophy, if you think that, you haven't dug very deep into your own belief set.
Yeah.
You haven't thought about it much at all. You'd be laughed out of a first year philosophy class if you said that, right? It would be so easy to demonstrate that you hold beliefs that you can't defend, right? We all do, right? At the very bottom, I mean, here's a classic example. Everyone's heard of the problem of induction, although most people don't understand, but there's something called the problem of deduction, right? How do you justify deduction? How do you establish that, you know, a rule like modus ponens or the principle of non-contradiction, right? That that these are true, and that that applying them results in truths. You know, that is, if you have the right premises and you apply the inference rules, you'll get the right conclusion. How do you establish that? What are you going to use to establish that? What process of thinking are you going to use to establish the veracity, the reliability, and the validity of deduction, other than the norms of logic, right? You're going to use modus ponens. If A implies B, A therefore B, right? You're going to abide by the principle of non-contradiction. You're going to use deduction in any attempt that you try to put forth in defense of deduction. That has a name, right? That's arguing in a circle, right? That's circular reasoning. That's begging the question, right? At the any logician will tell you this, that you can't defend logic without using logic. There isn't another one. People say, oh yeah, I can rely on evidence. Evidence is only evidence when it's in the form of an argument. To say that X is a piece of evidence for Y is to say that it's a piece of evidence for a certain conclusion, right? It's to say precisely that this piece of evidence is a premise in an argument that leads to a certain conclusion. That's what evidence is. Evidence is a piece, is a reason in an argument, mm-hmm. right? And so there's no getting around this, right? So people who often think that there's a position called epistemism, right? People who reject all faith. They say, I hold nothing on faith. Everything I believe on logic and evidence, you know, great. You haven't thought things through very far. Epistemism is one of the most ridiculous claims. It's laughably wrong, and it's demonstrably wrong, but you can only embrace that position if you haven't thought it through very far, right? Right. Now, it's certainly true that just because there are certain things that we accept, perhaps have to accept without good arguments, that's not a license to believe any old damn thing on insufficient evidence. It's not a license to believe any old damn thing, that maybe there are some things that we just have to accept on insufficient evidence, right? I think that sort of the norms of reasoning, for instance, are those that there are certain basic assumptions, they're sometimes called properly basic beliefs, or you might think of them as axioms, that inform rationality, that form the very structure, the basis, the foundations of rationality and reasonableness.
How would you say paraconsistency enters into this?
How would what?
How would you say paraconsistency speaks to this question?
Oh, well, there are systems of paraconsistent logic that reject the principle of non-contradiction. And that's a whole other – I don't want to get into dialectic logic because it gets too hairy.
But it is a little monkey wrench in the works. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah. No, I mean logic isn't what people think it is. It's not as simple as that. I mean, there are literally systems of logic where a contradiction is sometimes acceptable. Paraconsistent systems of logic are examples of that. The logic that we normally use is two-valued logic. Everything is true or it's false, and anything has the truth value of F, false, if it isn't truth value, true. And so in true value, two-value logic, everything is, you know, T or F. But there are different systems of logic that have three variables, not just two. So my point would be this, that there are people who are so committed to rationality and skepticism and reason and logic and do so naively that they avoid using perfectly good words like faith and belief, naively thinking that those are nay words, but words like logic and reason and evidence are yay words, and they will pretend that that they don't have any faith-based commitments and unjustified or unwarranted beliefs, and those people are living. Those people are truly deluded, right? And that's a serious delusion. And if you're committed to that, if you believe that, you're going to be hard pressed to find out that you're wrong about that.
Ozzie,
right? And it's important to know our epistemological limitations.
totally
agree. It sounds like you're talking about some of the guests that I've had on my show.
Yeah, well, I mean, Aaron Ra, for instance, is someone who self-identifies as an epistemist, and I think it's a preposterous position. I mean, it's a term coined by a notable YouTube atheist who I'm not going to start naming names, you know, but I mean it's kind of a nice word. I'm glad that the word exists because it in fact does name a certain kind of person, a certain type. But I think that the position is preposterous, right? So I think people are mistaken to self-identify that way. But I'm glad that there are people who self-identify that way. They at least know that that's what they think explicitly. There are a lot of people who I think are epistemists who don't know that they are, and who are embracing this naive view. But I think what's happening there is you have a group of people who are committed to rationality and skepticism. And scientific values who don't understand their own epistemological limitations.
That's true.
And that is a liability. That is, you know, I mean, that's a real mistake. Anybody who respects reason, rationality, scientific values, and skepticism, one of the things you should be most concerned about is what are the limits of what we can know? What within my belief set is actually not well warranted and well justified? And the reason that's important is because your confidence needs to scale according to how well justified things are. And
it is precisely because hypotheses can be false. Certain hypotheses can be formed in such ways as they can be falsified that skepticism is a worthy way of approaching them. There's ways of pushing back on the skepticism that work.
I want to read one more comment that Bob made to me in a private FaceTime event. And I think this really makes some sense here. He said, "To ask these questions asked in the so-called Great Debate, it seems to me that we need to abandon definitions of God and let the possibility of God be a God of almost any sort. Otherwise, we begin omitting possibilities simply because they don't fit the definitions. And we do so without ever having determined beforehand if the definitions are proper, fair, knowable, or even realistic."
Now, you want me to comment on that?
Yeah.
Yeah, although I believe in God, I don't know that I actually have any kind of well-formed sense of what that would mean for a God to be a God. I don't feel competent to the assessment. There is just within me that sense that there is, you know, something there. I mean, you know, who knows? Maybe even Shanaraki is right. It's just some sort of deism. I don't know. I find that when I'm trying to reduce this to some determinable, knowable, reliable concept, I don't like what I'm coming up with. I don't like the idea that I could be coming up with something that is determinable. Possible, maybe. You know, so I find that for me, the question of whether or not God exists, I've had to divorce it from specific concepts of what God is, because I do find problems with those concepts that strike me as, various sorts of problems, you know. That so I don't know that, now that this becomes extremely weak, in my opinion. And so, therefore, it may not even possess any kind of remarkable value. But, it's just that I found myself having to abandon notion after notion as being as useful in any kind of demand to someone else that they somehow believe. I'm certainly one of these theists where I have no desire to try to persuade someone else to believe. I mean, you do or you don't. It either resonates with you or it doesn't. And I'm not so sure I even understand all the validity or the reasons for why it is I find myself in that state of mind where I am one who believes.
Ozzy.
I'm not sure what I'm supposed to address there.
Just any of the things that, you know, Bob said after I read his, after I read what he said to me on FaceTime, because, you know, we have these awesome conversations and from time to time he makes these statements that I like to write down. And so I thought it would be useful in the show tonight because it's, you know, this is a conversation. We're trying to get to know each other. We're trying to understand what each other might be saying. That is what's coming out of the head. And hopefully we're doing that tonight. Both of you guys have provided excellent data tonight that we need to contemplate. But what are your thoughts on what Bob said?
I'm still really uncomfortable. This is going to take us back the last two hangouts that we did about Bob's belief in a God. His belief seems to amount to it's a little more than just a possibility. So my sense is if you have a belief in something that you know is just a bare possibility and that you can't specify to yourself good reasons for thinking that it's true, like more likely to be true than not, then you should be scaling back your confidence. You should be reconsidering and reevaluating whether or not you should believe that. Now, you don't decide whether you're going to believe something or not. That just happens to you. But I think that in time, what happens is if you take seriously the idea that I shouldn't believe things that I don't have good reason to believe, and I should believe things where I do have good reason to believe, even if I don't want to believe it. Right, it works both ways. Then I think what happens over time is, as a result of a commitment to that principle, this is the key to belief revision, and rejection and belief adoption. So my feeling is when I hear Bob talk about his reasons being so ambiguous and the ambivalence with which he states his belief. He's not ambivalent in that he believes, but he's ambivalent about why he believes. My feeling is, if it were me, I would say, I don't think I have any reason believing this. Now, I'm not going to pretend that I don't believe it. If I believe it, I believe it, period. But I what I would say, if it were me, if I were in Bob's position, I would say, given that I believe this, and my own stated reasons about the state of the evidence, I don't think I have any business believing this. That's my view of it.
Yeah, I agree with much of what you said there, and indeed I would say that it is at least scaled back my confidence to the level of certainly not feeling that I have any right to attempt to impose or bring anyone in on my own thoughts on this. And I do have to be honest about the fact that I do believe. But I think it takes us back to maybe this true temp guy. You know, like I say, I have this constant experience of this otherness. Am I true temp? Or I don't know. But I find that I can't walk away from that as much as I might like to. And when I try to make sense of it from just the – so it's not like I believe for reasons that I have thought the reasons through. And so, well, now that's why I believe. But I find that when I try to come up with, well, what would be a good reason for believing this, I find that I only come up with reasons that I find possess too many holes – too many ways in which the I could be wrong, that I certainly don't have confidence in the argument that I could offer, But the experience and the sense of it is for me also inescapable. And so I do find myself, you know, in that condition of belief. And as a result, this is one of the reasons why I turn to what I call, you know, agnostic theism. Now, that may not be the best terms to use, but it works for me in terms of saying that. And so I do think, in a sense of scaling back the confidence, I think I have. I think that I have perceived this as something where I'm very comfortable recognizing that I could be totally wrong.
Ozzie, are you suggesting that, you know, if a person has an inarticulate theology or, let's say, an inarticulate X, it's wrong to have a belief?
No, it's not that. It has to do with how one assesses the evidence. If in one's own assessment the evidence for one's belief is completely ambiguous, right? Such that one feels ambivalent about it, then you should be ambivalent about believing it in the first place.
Well, I don't feel ambivalent about it. I
No, but the state of the evidence, though, right?
Right. Right. Yeah. Right, yeah. Yeah. So, which is why you know, I'm no evangelist.
Yeah, and I mean, clearly, I said this last week or maybe the week before that you're a very, very introspective fellow, and as a result, you have drastically revised your beliefs. You've completely scaled back your confidence, right? It just seems to me that, you know, if I were in your shoes, I would have to conclude, okay, well, I don't have any business believing this, right? No. I might believe helplessly, but nevertheless,
To me, if it's that ambiguous, there is no business to have or not have, in a sense. So so for me, it is merely being honest about the fact that that is the condition and state I find myself to be in. For whatever it might be worth, it's certainly not worth defending. I believe in God. I don't believe in theology, but that doesn't mean that I haven't kind of, in some ways, worked out a theology. I mean, for example, if there is a God, evidently this God has a certain level of patience or lack of awareness of us, because we don't seem to be requiring any kind of obvious intervention, you know. there's a sense in which if there is a God, there's certain things that have to be very consistent with what we find to be the case, and that's not always an easy thing to work out either. But but I just find myself in that condition. And so it has scaled back my confidence. And I like a lot of what you've said. And indeed, it is because I've discussed this with people who are really good at, feathering out the justifications and the lack of them and the possible explanations for certain experiences, observations, that it has brought me to the point of abandoning a sense of certainty about it.
I've got one last, well, probably not last question, but we are at the end of the show and we do need to close, and I'd like to hear your final points. I'd like to bring Daryl in simply to read a comment or two. But I do have this curiosity question, and it's been, in a sense, just bugging me. Ozzie, question is for you. If there are possibly three positions, that is, let's call theism a position. Let's call theism a position. And let's call the agnostic a position. Which position is a bit more rational than the other two?
Well, whether or not a position, you know, one judges a position to be rational depends on how one assesses the evidence, okay? So, I mean, on my assessment of the evidence, I think atheism is the way to go. I think atheism is more rational than theism. Okay, but not everyone has to see it that way. I mean, a position, a conclusion, a proposition like God exists, God doesn't exist, or maybe a God exists, or I don't know if a God exists, right? All of these propositions, no proposition by itself is rational, right? It's an argument that for a proposition that is rational, right? People are rational. Arguments are rational, right? Positions aren't rational. Not in and of themselves. It's only how you argue for them, right? Now, I think some propositions are so divorced from any plausible argument for them that as a shortcut, we can say that position is completely irrational. But that is just a shorthand way of saying there's no rational pathway to this conclusion, okay? But I don't think that that's true with theism. I think that there are forms of a belief in God where a person can actually have a rational argument. I don't think that the argument is I think that these somewhere along the way there are going to be unwarranted premises and perhaps an inferential gap here and there, such that I wouldn't endorse it. Okay, but if the person in question doesn't see it that way, if they think the premises are sound, then they have a rational argument for their theism. That's why I don't go around saying that theism is intrinsically irrational and that all theists are irrational or something like that, just because I think that my own atheism is more rational than those positions, right? So I think atheism is the more rational position, but one has to see the evidence as I see it to think that. There's no relativism here. One of us is going to be wrong about this. You know, it might be me. Okay, so I don't want to be misunderstood as saying, oh, Ozzy is saying, you know, it all depends on the person. It doesn't. No, what depends on the person is how they see it, whether or not a person is being rational. Because if a person believes something for terrible reasons, and they understand that it's terrible reasons, then they're being rationally incontinent. They know that they're being irrational. Okay, but somebody is wrong here. Okay.
Right.
And it's difficult to establish which of us is incorrect. Okay. But people of goodwill can disagree about a question like this because it's not like there's a test that you can. This is not a quickly decidable issue where we'll just test to see if there's a God or not.
Excellent.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because the thing that we're positing. Okay. Is usually it's something that stands outside of time and space and stuff like that. And one objection is, well, great. Well, what reason is there to think that? Well, look, theists have reasons. They give reasons. They give cosmological arguments. They give arguments about contingency. They give moral arguments. They give aesthetic arguments. They do give arguments. Okay. Now you might say, well, I don't think those are good arguments. Okay. But obviously they do, right? They obviously think those are good arguments, right? No, well, you don't, Bob, but a lot of people do. A lot of theists do think those are convincing arguments, and maybe they're deluded. They find them convincing because it conduces to their conclusion, right? But I mean, that's an objection that cuts both ways. Anybody can say that about an atheist's objection to those arguments. Oh, you just think that those objections to those arguments are good objections because it conduces to your preference for the conclusion that there's no God. That's neither here nor there. You can't have an argument that way by simply impugning a person's motives, right? As I see it, when we're talking about something like the creator of the physical reality that we inhabit, you're not talking about an empirical object to be met with in space that you can just examine with science. And so if a person says, oh, well, you know, science hasn't revealed it to us. Yeah, well, I'm not talking about a thing that science could reveal to us, right? It's like saying, you know, show me the number 7. You know, look, it's an object of thought, and it's a useful object of thought, and it's actually important in reality. But you can't demonstrate the number 7. It doesn't work that way, right? A flat Euclidean plane cannot be demonstrated. It doesn't exist in physical reality either. But it's absolutely indispensable in geometry, right? And it's possible that the concept of God is indispensable for understanding certain other concepts that we have, right? I mean, a presuppositionist would say, well, the concept of God is indispensable for understanding knowledge. Another person might say the concept of God is indispensable for having a concept of truth or a robust concept of morality and so forth, right? you have to have these arguments. You can't just dismiss them as, oh, well, you know, a guy in a white lab coat couldn't demonstrate that a God exists there, you know, therefore we just, you know, have to dismiss it. That's not the way to proceed. So the question is more complicated than that. And I obviously fall on one side of it, but people who are perfectly intelligent, perfectly reasonable can fall on the other side of this. And that's why I think it is a great debate. You know, it is much hinges on it, right? Depending on the God in question. Right. And even if you imagine a kind of clockmaker, a deistic God of classical deism, the clockmaker God who creates the world, winds it up and then walks away and has nothing to do with its creation, that's still consequential. Right. That what that means is that the world is an artifact and that things are designed and purposed. Right. As opposed to a set of physical accidents. Right. That has implications. Right. And they might be very, very far reaching. So it's still consequential, even if you have a conception of a God that is very, very far removed from the Abrahamic gods. So that's how I see it. So yes, I do think that some positions are more rational than others. Obviously, I think mine is the more rational position. I wouldn't hold it if I didn't think it was the more rational position. I would like to think that if I came to think that it wasn't the more rational, that I would abandon the position, right? Not immediately, but in time, I would lose the grip that my belief has on me, because that's how it is, would just loosen, and I would just, you know, I would lose that belief, right? Presently, I believe there are no gods. You know, I think that it's false that there are gods. The proposition, I subscribe to the proposition, God exists not, right? And applicable to any gods, right? But there are some conceptions of God that are so, you know, all I can say there is I'm kind of agnostic about them, right? Certain deistic conceptions, I have to say I'm kind of agnostic about them. It's not even right to say I'm an atheist about them. It's almost better to call me an agnostic about it. And I think agnosticism is a perfectly respectable position. The agnostic is someone who has typically looked at the evidence. Not necessarily deeply. They might have only looked at a couple of arguments, right, and only considered a few gods, right, that are on offer. But having looked at what they have looked at, said, I can't decide. Maybe the question is undecidable, right? Or maybe the question is undecidable by me right now. Maybe that will change. What's a person like that supposed to do? Pretend? Just declare? Just profess to be an atheist or profess to be a theist? Neither one of those would be rational. You should be an agnostic if in your view, the evidence is ambiguous. That's why I think that Bob, he describes himself as an agnostic theist. I think what he should be, given how he describes the state of the evidence, he should be an agnostic. You know, maybe that'll happen. Maybe the belief revision that I was talking about will lead in that direction. Maybe not. It can go either way, you know, or it could stay exactly where it is. So, you know, a conclusion by itself is not rational or irrational. That's only a shorthand way of speaking to say that a position is rational or irrational. True. It's just to say that there is a pathway through reason to get to the conclusion, or there isn't. This question is actually hard, and it's not clear cut. And people who think that it is clear cut and talk about it as if it's clear cut just haven't done a lot of reading.
Yeah, that's good. You know, sometimes I think that it would be better to have a debate, not just with a theist and an atheist, but to have an agnostic in the debate as well, simply to hear from people who are just unsure. You know, they just will say, I don't know. And so the I don't know position, in my opinion, is something that I think that we need to hear a little bit more about. Daryl.
Can I say one more thing?
Yes.
Oh, sorry.
I just want
to say one last thing. That one of the things I find most frustrating in the great debate is people on both sides, theists and atheists, insisting that agnosticism is a position of intellectual cowardice and moral cowardice. I really can't stand that. Yes, it's true that there are some people who are so concerned about the stigma of atheism there are some atheists out there who are so concerned about the stigma of atheism that they don't want to call themselves atheists. They'll call themselves agnostic. You know, what's his name? Neil deGrasse Tyson springs to mind. He, I think, is self-identifies as an agnostic, and I think he does so entirely in bad faith. He is an agnostic in name only. He is an atheist. Everything that comes out of his mouth suggests that he's an atheist, and he's just afraid to. And it's largely for political reasons that he does so. So there are such people, okay? But it's not. But that's not true of everybody who self-identifies as an agnostic. I think that agnosticism is an intellectually respectable stance, and it's simply people. Theists and atheists do this all the time. They malign agnostics as being intellectually cowards and moral cowards because they say that, you know, look, either there's a God or no God, so you have to make up your mind, you know. And that's why I gave that analogy a couple of weeks ago about. Or last week, you know, look, the number of hydrogen atoms in the universe is either even or odd. Which are you, an evenist or an oddist? Well, hell, I don't know, you know. And for some agnostics, they go, well, look, that's how it looks to me. I cannot make up my mind, right? And now to other people, they'll say, look, it's not 50-50. Yeah, it looks 50-50 to me, says the agnostic. What are they supposed to do, right? Or they might say it's 51-49 one day, and it's 49-51 the next day. What am I supposed to do? You know, flip back and forth? No, I'm sorry. Until they arrive at a position that's a little bit more stable, where I think the odds tip significantly one way more than the other, I'm going to stay on the fence, right? Being on the fence is a provisional position, and that's respectable. Anyway, I said I'd be brief and I wasn't. I'm sorry. Daryl was next.
Daryl, give us a little bit of what's going on in the chat.
Okay. Yeah. First of all, I lost my access to the comments about midway through the show. So I only have basically where we started, but I think there's some worth mentioning. Someone said, I thought the great debate was Ginger or Marianne. And someone responded to that, no, it's vanilla or chocolate.
So, no, it's Marianne all the way.
That's what somebody else said.
I think that was me.
Was it you? Okay. Well, there were a couple that I thought were worth mentioning. One says that debates only decide the question of who is the best debater. Another one says the great debate is a distraction. Exactly. The questions are all done with, old and done with, need new questions. And to me, you know, that was a pretty good observation, because I think for the better part of this show, I think we had better questions. I personally think the content really went up when we just kind of sidestepped the great debate and really started talking about some important issues. And I would like to provide my own a couple of comments. You know, I don't make much of it these days, but I do consider myself to be a theist. And in my thinking, if it turns out there is a God, I would think of him as someone who would be comfortable saying, you know, I'm kind of like Ozzy. And I want to say this about Bob. Bob, you know, you amaze me. I honestly can't imagine. I mean, some of the things you said tonight were so brutally honest, and I really can't imagine growing up never feeling the embrace of a parent. I mean, gosh, that is such a powerful thing. And yet at the same time, you know, when I, once again, when I think of God, I think of someone who embraces us, you know. And there's been times in my life where, in one sense, I don't know that I could have made it through certain circumstances without some sense of that. And, you know, it doesn't, and at this point in my life, it doesn't have to be real. It can turn out one day, maybe the proof comes out that there absolutely can't be a God. Okay, you know, but it's still nice to enjoy this sense of connection and this sense of embracing and self-worth and so on. And so those are my comments.
Thank you, Daryl. You know, I've had so many comments come in during the week concerning the shooting incident in South Carolina. It's an unfortunate situation. But many people have been stating, wow, look how theists are coming to the rescue as opposed to atheists. And I would like to have that discussion because I don't think that that's true. I think that atheists and theists are coming to the rescue in that they are pushing for a better sense of morality than what we find in any holy book. And unfortunately, I think that we as theists, we typically like to give all the credit and honor and glory to God. And I think that atheists are right in saying, why can't we give credit to ourselves? And so with that said, Ozzy, I would like to give you your final words tonight. And I'd like to thank you for being on the program. You always add so, so much. And I thank you for answering all of the questions that I asked of you because, you know, providing the kind of wisdom and knowledge that you do on this show, it really helps all of us. And so thank you for being a blessing here.
Well, thank you. As usual, my cup runneth over. That's very generous.
By the way, God was defined. You are God.
Okay. My wife will be very alarmed to learn this. Oh, dear. To sum up, the great debate is as great as you make it. I'll just go back to that maxim that I affirm a lot. It just, we all get the conversations we deserve. If you find that the great debate isn't so great, then you just need to up your game. Do a little bit of reading, talk to different people, and avoid playing chess with people who cheat and are just going to frustrate you. But if you do enjoy that, if you want to go slumming, then that's fine. That's your prerogative. But then don't complain about it and don't insist that there's nothing to this question. It's an important question. It's consequential. It is a question that is of interest to people all over the world, all kinds of cultures, for millennia now. It's not going anywhere, you know. And just saying I won't participate in it, I mean, it doesn't matter. Like, you know, the conversation doesn't care if you participate in it or not. What matters is if you participate, how you participate in it. And are you just going to go into, you know, hangouts and on message boards and, you know, shout people down on the street and stuff like that and abuse people? And or are you going to try to actually have a conversation and learn and maybe change a few minds, either the person you're talking to or perhaps by modeling the right kind of behavior and the right kind of conversational techniques, maybe influence other people who are looking on? I think that's the way to proceed.
Excellent. Excellent. Bob, what are your final thoughts?
Well, I enjoyed this conversation again. I always appreciate Ozzy and always admire his clarity of expressing various ideas and his great knowledge in terms of, we talked about ill-defined and well-defined. I think that Ozzy has a great knowledge of the way various different questions have been asked, answered, responded to, and sharpened. When it comes to the great debate, I suppose that that I prefer the concept of a discussion. I don't know that the debate is the format that this indismissible question is best served by, but I do think we definitely need to discuss it, to talk about it, to appreciate and understand where people are coming from. I myself, I have come to the point where, as a result of my own attempts, I have come to the limitations of my own capacities to appreciate that which can be reasoned out in it, which is why I've become an agnostic, I suppose. But nonetheless, it still remains that it either is the case that there is or is not a con. And I find that that in a sense, and perhaps what Daryl even made reference to is a part of it. I've had it suggested to me that that perhaps in growing up the way that I did, that that maybe somehow God is my imaginary friend who got me through this. I think that there's some merit in that in that assertion, that that is well within the possibilities of certain psychological dynamics that we certainly understand. But I don't find that that argument is also compelling either. So, you know, it does nonetheless leave me in the position of being a person who does believe. And yet when I stop to try to reason it through, I find myself very unsatisfied with all of the directions I try to take with it. So, you know, consequently, agnostic, theist. If I might someday become just an agnostic, that's fine. I don't, I really don't want to put my ego into it. I enjoy the discussion. I think there's a great deal to enjoy in it, and to really, it helps you to be aware of your own capacity to think. And I really, although I do believe in God, I don't believe in a God that's where this is going to make a difference. You know, I mean, because it strikes me, if I have such a struggle in trying to nail this down one way or the other as being more rational, I can't conceive of there being a God who's thinking, "What, you idiot? You know, you should have figured this out. What the hell's wrong with you?" You know, I instead could picture one saying, "Yeah, sorry about that," or something like that. You know, it's just the nature of the incompleteness of what we have access to from within this thing we call life. I don't know, but so it leaves me there. But I tell you. It's certainly, I like things that Ozzy says, such as, you know, the need to scale back the confidence. I can agree with a great deal of what he says about, and it does, and from standpoint of rationale, it brought me to agnosticism, definitely. There, I don't have a rational theism. I have a rational agnosticism. I have an embrace of my experience that I make sense of in a way that I'm not even trying to make sense of it or trying not to make sense of it, that I live in what strikes me as the presence of a far more patient, far more understanding sentience than that's in many ways leaves me as a person who's, I'm not worried about anything.
One of the most powerful things that I think that I see in the great debate is it's bringing people together. It's a conversation that needs to be had, and I think that if we become compassionist, atheist and theist alike, that's when we all win. And there's something about learning how to be kind in a conversation, intellectually kind, learning how to be intellectually patient, learning how to give intellectual charity, learning how to make our arguments, our thoughts known, trying to raise the bar, if you will, on humanism, maybe a humanism 2.0 is what we all need. And so I would like to ask you, get involved in not just the great debate, but get involved in humanity. Humanity right now is suffering. Right now we've had a tragedy that is in South Carolina. Get involved in the healing process. You are important, very important to the change. Thank you for your time. Thank you.